Friends, ladies and gentlemen, let us go to this module 1, the evolution of colonoscopy. We are all curious, peeping through these small keyholes to look what's inside. Looking inside, that is endo or colonoscopy, because we all know seeing is believing. That is what this particular video is going to show you. Let us watch this.
The evolution of endoscopes has been driven by doctors who have always dreamt of bringing better care to patients and engineers who made efforts to make these dreams come true. It has also been supported by new technological developments in product.
What a fascinating story, isn't it? It's not happened in a few days. Decades of hard work by many scientists across the globe, it's all possible. So I'm going to give you a gist of the history of colonoscopy by these 6 major headings, starting from the concept of the endoscopy. This great personality, Philip Bozzini, he is actually the person who thought we should be able to see inside the patient's or the people's body cavity by throwing the light, by what we call the light leader or light conductor. By using simple candlelight, he was able to see the interior of the oral cavity and the vagina. So I would say he is probably the father of concept of endoscopy. Then came Antonin Desormix, a French guy who, along with the Chary, he invented this particular telescope which is able to illuminate our body cavity by using the turpentine oil. And actually he only coined apparently the term what we use day in and day out, that is endoscope. Then came, of course, all of you know, a famous urologist, Macmillan Nitz. He used the electric bulb for quite long time. That used to be the case until that now we are using the cold light. Let us move on to the next important thing from the concept to the history of the gastroscope, because the birth of colonoscopy actually followed the path of gastroscopy. This particular person, Adolf Kussmaul, as you can see, a German, he is actually claimed to be the father of rigid endoscopy, because he saw several of these sword swallowers in the street and he was fascinated how they are able to swallow. So he was wondering, why can't I put a hollow tube, a light, so that I can ask them to insert inside their gullet and see what's happening inside their esophagus and stomach. That's what he did, and he was fascinated by the view. And he did the same thing in otherwise normal people. There he had a problem, not able to see because of lack of insufflation and endangering the patient's life by perforation. So this is a little history behind the futile attempt by Adolf Kussmaul. But every year you watch this particular event is happening in
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Last one.
Thanks to Miklos Radecki, a Polish guy, he only, I'm sure, he can be claimed to be the father of gastroscopy, mainly to the fact he knew the importance of insufflation and also the removal of the fluid inside. It may look cumbersome procedure, the way the picture depicted there, but I think he only said whatever is required in the present scope, like the importance of the suction, the importance of insufflation. So I would say this is a very important personality and a landmark discovery which led to the proper scope. But I would think the teacher's teacher is this guy, Rudolf Sindler, a German, as you can see, with the way he traveled. He had a little wooden suitcase in which he carried the semi-flexible endoscopy. He varied places in USA and also UK and also Europe. He traveled along with his staff, as you can see here in this beautiful picture, where the patient is lying there and he is doing, and who is holding the head? Initially that was his nurse. Later he married her because she was so loyal and so important component of the team, Gabriella. So Gabriella and he, they did the scope together, and without Gabriella, he couldn't do the procedure. So that is the importance of how you need to hold the patient's head, especially when you do a rigid or semi-flexible endoscopy. So we need to know the importance of your team or the team member. Of course, these two personalities, and we need to be proud of at least one person, that is Narinder Singh Kapani, along with the Harold Hopkins, because most of you know Hopkins, because Hopkins lens system in laparoscopy also we used to use. But Kapani was a rich scholar in the London University, and he is claimed to be the father of fiber optics, because he taught the world that light can travel across the corner because of what we call the total internal reflection. And he discovered the finest of the fine fiber optics and put them all in a bundle and able to conduct the light. So he is a man behind that, but the secret was there with him. From him, this particular personality, basically a South African, but moved to the USA, Basil Hiskovich. He knew all the secrets from Kapani, then went to USA along with Larry Curtis and also Corning Glass Company. Both, he was able to make what we call today the flexible fiber optic endoscopy. And you can see how easily he is doing with the patient sitting. He is doing, and this particular picture was flashed all across the globe. In a overnight, he became world famous. Then the history is there. So that's the way the rigid flexible endoscopy born. From there, slowly we started moving into the other end of your gut, that is sigmoid and colon. The birth of sigmoidoscopy is similar, and we had for more than 100 years what we call the rigid sigmoidoscopy, a metal tube with the obturator with a light at the end, what we call a Strass rigid sigmoidoscopy. Usually we use in the left lateral positions, but also in the knee elbow position has also been described. And as you can see here, another personality, as you can see here, Overholt in Illinois, he is holding his beautiful flexible fiber optic sigmoidoscopy. With that, he is able to go right up to the descending colon. Then came the fiber optic colonoscopy, looking at the most of the colon at least. It was a long journey for most of the scientists in order to design and to carry the light all along, because navigation was a challenge. Initially, like what we did in stomach also, they had what we call a colonocamera, wherein we don't have a view as it is. Once the scope is passed, then when you withdraw, you have various pictures are taken. You need to develop the picture in order to see any pathology. Very cumbersome procedure, colonocamera, but it was done initially. But then the fight was on who to develop a fiber optic colonoscopy. Is it American or the Japanese? American ACMI, as you can see here, they designed this beautiful what we call a colonoscopy, that is American cystoscopy makers. But the very important limitation is their flag hand technique. So it is only able to move in one direction. So the navigation was not as good as one would anticipate. But Japan, as you can see, so many members were on the hunt, starting with the NEMA from Olympus in 1965. And Matsunaga and then Yamagata and his colleagues, they all tried various ways. Initially, as you can see, they were able to reach the right colon only in a small percent of the people, like 8%. You can't imagine. Now, you know, you need to reach the cecum in 95%. That is what is expected. Imagine they were at 8%. So everything when they started, the struggle, the steep learning, the difficulty they faced. But obviously by people, companies like Olympus, later by Pendex and Fujinon, we had a lot of design modification. Now they developed what we call the beautiful 140 degree angulation colonoscopy. Then came these teaching attachments. We all know this. I think even 30, 40 years ago, we used to have at the end of the fiber optic, we need to have. So you see, teach one and then other person start doing. Okay, this is the way we teach. Then, of course, the diagnostic colonoscopy changed into a therapeutic colonoscopy thanks to these two great personality, especially Hiromi Shinya. He is an American. So, he was along with the cardiologist William Wolf, both of them, they were able to demonstrate the world the importance of the polypectomy, because we all know that early removal of polyp is essential in order to prevent the cancer, that is adenoma carcinoma sequence is broken. So that's where he described, I am sure there are a lot of innovations after that, especially in 1973, the Dale from Erlangen, he actually described the importance of the submucosal saline cushion in order to avoid any transmural damage of the bowel. So there are a lot of things, but I think we need to admire the courage, wisdom of Hiromi in order to develop this really innovative landmark publication and event. So that's the thing. And the final thing, of course, is the birth in the last 20 years, the fight was on to develop what we call the video colonoscopy, like a video endoscopy. Here is a video colonoscopy. So initially, it was the Keymed in London. What they did, they just attached the camera right at the eyepiece of a fiber optic, and you are able to see whatever is in the monitor. That is simpler waveform. But I think the charged couple device, the birth of it, that made the possibility of changing the photon to electrons. So you are able to use a truly video colonoscopy. Wells Allen company, they made in USA. But that was not there for a long time. 1980s is gone. I think the Japanese only they persevered. There are a lot of companies in Japan, and then later in Germany, then Russia, everybody on the hunt for this device. As you can see, trolley after trolley, you can see various types and various companies with their features are now available, because we all know the importance of the, I need not tell you now, video colonoscopy. The image is very terrific, and also the team. When I see one, my assistant also sees therapy is possible. I can transmit the image not only to the next room, to the next continent. So these are all thanks to the video technology, especially. And also nowadays scopes, you will soon learn, if you haven't known, that you can completely immerse in a cleaning solution. So that cleaning also is very, very easy. There is no chance of water logging or water getting into this system. So HD is the in thing, as I said, because of the increasing pixels. Initially it was only about a million or so. Now it is so good, so you are able to have a sharper, better image with a good magnification, and also the image enhancement by either narrowband, eye scan or the SPICE. Because you know, we have to keep inventing, because necessity is the mother of invention. That's what the Pluto said, and also there is a lot of innovation. I'm sure this particular slide, whatever I'm giving you a glimpse, we are going to write a chapter on itself. At the end, you'll be able to see that also on what is meant by a cytocolonoscopy, colonoscopy with artificial intelligence, 330 degree colonoscopy, and also the capsule colonoscopy, wherein you just take a capsule, that capsule will take all the pictures of colon. And also the finally the robotic colonoscopy. So the inventions are endless, and optical diagnosis is possible, because that is very important for an optimum treatment nowadays in 2020. And as Steve Jobs said earlier, innovation distinguishes whether you are a leader or just a follower. So we want to be a leader, you have to keep innovating. So that's the thing. So if you want to know more about all this evolution, I would recommend all of you to read this beautiful book by two great personalities in colonoscopy. Jerome Bain is an American, Christopher Williams from St. Mark's in London. So both of them are very good colonoscopists. I am sure there are various bigger and also personalities even in India. They all taught, like ourselves in IAGS, like Satyapriya, myself, Dr. Goindraj, Subhas Khanna, there are a lot of people there out there. We are all willing to transfer and skill, and also we are passionate about teaching the art and science of colonoscopy. So join us in the journey, and this particular module, once you finish, we will take you to the next module to tell you what is inside a colonoscopy, how to use the colonoscopy. Until then, thank you very much. Okay, finished.